Hi everyone, and welcome to the Aerospike Educational Series. This is a series of videos that we're going to release in order to explain a little bit better how the Aerospike engine works. So today is the first chapter, and we will go through the working principle of the Aerospike and a little bit of history, why it has never flew in the past, and what are we doing nowadays in order to make it fly here at Pangea Aerospace. So, first of all, what is this thing that is here next to me? This is an aerospike engine, in fact. This is ARCOS. It's 30 tons methane and liquid oxygen aerospike engines that we are developing right now at Pangea Aerospace. And this is based on the heritage of a smaller aerospike engine, Demo P1. You can check the video in the description that we already tested in DLR Lampoldshausen last year. So we are using the same technology and heritage that we already tested on Demo P1 in order to make ARCOS a reality. So how does ARCOS work, and how does an aerospike engine in general work? It's quite different compared to a bell nozzle because it's basically the same shape but reversed. So in a bell nozzle, what you have is a bell where a supersonic flow can expand, and this supersonic flow has no information about the ambient that's outside. So what can happen is that when the flow is exiting the bell, the ambient is recompressing the flow and can even enter inside the flow of the bell, basically destroying the nozzle. So a bell nozzle can only be designed for one altitude, whereas it will behave suboptimally at every other different altitude, which is sea level and vacuum. So bell nozzles perform inefficiently at sea level and in vacuum. Whereas an aerospike, such as ARCOS, basically has an open nozzle that you can see in here. So this, in the case of an aerospike, is called the plug, and it's quite the opposite of a bell in the sense that the flow can actually exit from a gap that is here, that is the throat of the engine, and can expand freely on this plug, meaning that the flow is only constrained in the middle by this plug, whereas it's free to expand on the exterior because it has no constraint. The only constraint it has is the actual ambient, but this means that ambient pressure actually will squeeze the plume just enough to give you optimal adaptation performance. So an aerospike, as we say, works optimally at every different altitude. So it can be designed with a very high expansion ratio to work well in vacuum, for example, but then it will also perform very well at sea level. This is the big advantage of the engine. So then, if the aerospike has already been tested in the past, why did it never fly? And the answer to this is because of cooling and manufacturing issues. So an aerospike engine is more efficient, up to 15% more efficient, but it's very hard to cool it because where the throat is in this region, you also have the biggest section of the engine, and you need to cool it down, which means a very high integrated heat flux. So in the past, what they would do is to brace tiny tubes together with manual operations, with brazing, which meant and resulted in the human error and uncertainty manufacturing and non-repeatability. And plus, it was a very expensive procedure. Nowadays, what we're doing at Pangea Aerospace is leveraging on 3D printing techniques in order to be able to cool the throat of the aerospike in a very efficient way. Plus, we are cooling the two parts of the engine, so the external part with liquid methane and the internal part, the plug, with liquid oxygen, so that we can maximize the expansion ratio of the engine and maximize the surface that has to be cooled, because we can cool it with both propellants and we want to maximize the expansion ratio with an aerospike engine to get up to 15% more efficiency compared to a conventional bell nozzle. So that's a wrap, and this is the end of chapter one of the Aerospike Education Series. We know maybe a little bit better how an aerospike works and what we should do to maximize the performance of an aerospike, but in chapter two we will see more in detail what is the actual difference in performance between a bell and an aerospike. So stay tuned for that.